happen to you? That do you still cry when you watch the movie titled The Passion for Christ? I remember the days of the emotional torture that we usually have back home then. So when we finish watching this film, we will see how, you know, we begin to remember how Jesus was beaten, how he was nailed to the cross. You know, we now feel sorry for him, we pity him so much because he's a good guy, you know, and because he didn't do anything for killing him. He didn't commit any sin. In fact, Pilate was asking the people, what offense has this man committed? And they said they couldn't find anything that he did. However, they said, kneel him to the cross. So what would have brought about kneeling him to the cross? Hi everyone, my name is Darren Dami Paul, to be precise, and I welcome everyone to this simple podcast. And this day, it's indeed a Good Friday, and I would like to share the word of God with everyone who is going to be listening to me at this time. And I usually say that I usually jump for joy whenever I see the empty tomb and the empty cross. I rejoice whenever I see this. And why should I rejoice? Because, you know, the Bible says that in the book of Luke chapter 24, from verse 17, if you read it downward to 26, you know, after Jesus had been crucified, and the people were very, very angry. They were not happy because they have experienced the goodness of Jesus, and they know him as a healer, as a miracle worker. So that he was killed wasn't a thing of joy to them. So the disciples, they were angry, they were not happy, they began to murmur, they began to talk. And you know, Jesus already resurrected and was among them. And Jesus asked one of them, said, what are you guys discussing about? And I said, well, we are discussing about Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who is a good man who was crucified. And Jesus answered them and said, oh, foolish of the hearts to believe. Don't you know that Jesus had to suffer these things so that he can enter into his glory? So what does this mean? Why is Jesus asking them not to pity him? Let them express their pains, but he's letting them know that that is not the issue. That which happened to Jesus be a thing of joy for them. So that is why I put it as a question to you, that do you still cry when you watch the movie titled The Passion for Christ? I remember the days of the emotional torture that we usually have back home then. So when we finish watching this film, we will see how, you know, we begin to remember how Jesus was beaten, how he was nailed to the cross. You know, we now feel sorry for him, we pity him so much because he's a good guy, you know, and because he didn't do anything for killing him. He didn't commit any sin. In fact, Pilate was asking the people, what offense has this man committed? And they said they couldn't find anything that he did. However, they said, kneel him to the cross. So what would have brought about kneeling him to the cross if not because it has a purpose for that? So after we have cried and, you know, repented, we go home sorrowful and fearful. So we begin to struggle with our life. We, you know, we want to live a holy life to compensate Jesus for the suffering that he suffered, for the killing that he was killed. So how can we, you know, make him happy? So we begin to struggle this period. I am not going to eat meat. I am not going to eat anything that has to do with blood, you know, just because the blood of Jesus was shed. So we begin to deny ourselves, you know, things that does not really have value to Jesus, you know. And after a while, we forget about it. Within a week after the Easter period, we forget about, you know, Jesus as somebody who is a good God again. So we continue to live our life again. So but today, we bless God. We bless God for revelation knowledge. And this is the revelation knowledge. It says that, you know, we no longer see Jesus as an ordinary man. We no longer see him as an ordinary good guy. In fact, somebody came to Jesus and said, oh, good master, you know, and Jesus returned to him and said, don't call me good. It's not as if he's not a good person, but he didn't want them to see him as a good person, but he wanted them to see him for who he is. So he said to them, I'm not a good person. I'm not a good man. It's only God in heaven that is good. So we no longer see him as a good guy. So we now see him as a savior. He is now a savior. We no longer struggle to be righteous. Why? Because he is now our righteousness. You know, when it comes to righteousness, these are the things that we use to please God. And that is why people, you know, they have to go extra mile, a lot of things, doing things, you know, in order to please God. But I tell you today, Jesus has already pleased God on our behalf. So when we have Jesus in us and we are in Jesus, then we are already pleasing God because we are righteous, and because Jesus, the righteousness, now lives in our life. So we no longer need to struggle to know to do sacrifices in order for us to be righteous, to know to do cleansings in order for us to be righteous. So we are now in righteousness. So we no longer struggle to be holy, you know, because we are now born in holiness. We are born in holiness. Christ gave birth to us. Except a man is born of the Spirit and of water, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So we are born of the Spirit. So we are holy. So we see ourselves as holy people now. So we live in holiness. So we no longer struggle to be holy, because holiness is now our bed. Holiness is our abode. Holiness is our house. So everything we do it in pride of the holiness that we are in. Now we see ourselves. We see ourselves as the royal priesthood, as a holy nation, a peculiar person, bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Now we can say we are free, and we are free indeed. And that same thing applies to you as well. You are free, and you are free indeed. So I want to assure you today that there is no reason for you to cry or feel sorry for Jesus. You know, Jesus suffering or Jesus' death. There is no need for you to feel sorry or feel sorrowful about it. So he is not expecting you to be sorrowful, but he wanted you to be joyous. He wanted you to be joyous. He wanted you to rejoice. He wanted you to jump up for joy, because that is the purpose of his death. So rejoice in the salvation that he has bought for you. This is the purpose of the suffering. So the purpose of the suffering is for you to be saved. And now that you are saved, what else? Rejoice in that salvation. It is his pleasure that he does that. It is his pleasure. He is not counting it as a sin upon you. That he was nailed or he was killed is not a sin unto you. It is a salvation unto you and I. So shout Hosanna as much as you can. Shout hallelujah and give glory to God. So whenever you watch Passion for Christ, if you're in peradventure, you're going to watch it in your church today. So whatever you see, whenever you see him being beaten, rejoice. Whenever you see him being nailed to the cross, so whenever you see his blood dropping, be glad that you are saved now and forevermore. You know, according to the book of Isaiah chapter 53, if you read it from verses 1 to 12, it makes us understand the purpose of the suffering and the purpose of the blood that will be shed for us. So it is for the remission of our sin and for the salvation of our life. So glorify Jesus whenever you see an empty tomb and an empty cross. This means that it is finished and the job is done. You know, I usually say something, don't look at the cross anymore, because Jesus is no longer on the cross. He only went through the cross, so he's no longer there. And don't look at the tomb anymore. Jesus is no longer in the tomb. He has left the tomb. He only passed through the tomb, because he has to die. So, you know, when people go on to go to Jerusalem today, it's not a crime to go to Jerusalem and see all this, I mean, these places. You want to go to Calvary. You want to go to the tomb where Jesus was buried. But when you now get there and begin to idolize the place, that's where concern comes. You can't get to Calvary today and think that that is where you will get forgiveness. No, Jesus is no longer at Calvary. He has left Calvary long years ago. He's no longer there. Not even a spirit dwelling there. No, you can't even find his blood on the floor there. Even if it's at its physical blood, it would have dried up and the rain would have washed it off. In fact, there was a mighty rain on that day. So you wouldn't even see the traces of his physical blood in that place. So there is nothing you are going to look for at Calvary. There is nothing you are going to look for in the tomb of Jesus Christ. And in fact, the people went to the tomb and the angel that was there told them, who are you looking for? They said, they are looking for Jesus. And the angel said, why are you looking for the living among the dead? So he actually told them that they shouldn't bother to come here again, because he's no longer there. So Jesus is no longer in the tomb. Jesus is no longer on the cross. He is alive, because he is the resurrection and life. So look unto the resurrected Jesus, who is seated on the right hand of the Father, interceding on our behalf, the author and the finisher of our faith, according to Hebrews chapter 12, from verses 1 to 3. So those that we are supposed to be sorrowful for, that we are supposed to be crying for, that we are supposed to be mourning for, are those that are still using dove for the remission of their sin, according to the Old Testament, you know, laws and rituals. Those that are still using the blood of animals, like lamb and goat, you know, for the remission of their sins, and those that are still paying ransom to prophets for cleansing, you know, for cleaning, for remission, They still pay money for it. So many people still pay money for deliverance. They still go to churches where they will charge them money before they can pray for them. So these are the people that we should weep for. These are the people that we should cry for. And not just weeping and crying. However, we should preach the gospel to them. These are the people that need the gospel. So they should no longer be in this thing. Christ has done everything. The blood of Jesus cannot be compared with the blood of a dove or the blood of an animal. You know, God no longer recognizes the blood of animals. He only recognize the blood of Jesus, and that is the only blood that can redeem us eternally. According to the book of Hebrews chapter 9 and read it from verse 13 to 28, you will see how much the blood of Jesus has done for us. So this is why I usually jump up and jump up for joy whenever I see the empty cross and the empty tomb. So all these are for for my sake and for your sake. So hallelujah to the Lord. And this means that there is no more weeping, there is no more eternal weeping, no more eternal sorrow, because Jesus has finished up everything eternally. So glory and glory and glory to Jesus. It is indeed a Good Friday. Congratulations to you. I welcome you, and I believe that you understood the purpose of redemption. And if you are here listening to me, you have not accepted Jesus as the Lord and personal Savior, you are really missing a lot, because there are a lot of things that you are missing. The joy of the Lord that you're supposed to be enjoying, the kingdom of God that you're supposed to be enjoying, the righteousness that you're supposed to be enjoying, the holiness that you're supposed to be living in and enjoying, you are missing out in those things. So I want to welcome you into the new kingdom, into Jesus Christ. Come into Him today. All ye that labor and are heavily laden, and the Lord Jesus is ready to give you rest. He will give your mind rest, and you will continue to live in peace. So congratulations once again, and I say to you, happy Good Friday and happy Easter in advance. God bless you. See you Wednesday. Bye.